Amistad and Harper Audio present Black Bottom Saints, a novel by Alice Randall, performed by Prentice Onayemi and Imani Parks. A note before we begin. Don't forget to download the accompanying enhancement PDF from your audiobook provider or go directly to www.harpercollins.com/audio/blackbottomsaints. This contains the recipes described in this book. Enjoy. Resurgit cineribus. We shall rise from the ashes. Introduction. Ask every person if he's heard the story, and tell it strong and clear if he has not, that once there was a fleeting wisp of glory called Camelot. Camelot. 7 years ago, in late 1961, I saw that musical in New York City. Detroit's best-known songstress daughter, Della Reese, was booked on the Ed Sullivan Show, which made the time right for a few of us to fly to Gotham from Motown. Making my way in a yellow cab after Camelot's closing curtain from the Majestic Theater on 44th Street to my Harlem home away from home, the Hotel Teresa on 125th Street, and whistling the title tune, I was thinking about Detroit, not Jack and Jackie. I was thinking about Maxine Powell, John White, Robert Hayden, and other Black Bottom Saints who need their story told strong and clear and loud. Nothing shines brighter than black polished right. Too often, we're too tired to get out the rag. Our brightest people and places get quickly forgotten and tarnished. Once there was a black Camelot, and right down the road from Black Camelot, otherwise known as Detroit, was Black Eden, otherwise known as Idlewild. Our resort town, Idlewild, Michigan, was a cross between Nantucket and Las Vegas. At the end of my life, a life that started in Chicago's Bronzeville in 1913, that whirled into gleaming hours in Harlem, St. Louis, Las Vegas, and Los Angeles, one place in time shined brighter than all the rest, Detroit City, from 1937 to 1967. And as quickly as I am writing, evidence of our shining hours, our shining places, our shining people is getting knocked down by the wrecking ball, dynamited to pieces in the name of urban renewal, singed in the embers of righteous rebellion, buried in cemeteries, locked up in an aging memory, and coughed out into oblivion. I'm sick. I'm probably dying. Bad kidneys, bad prostate, bad heart, struggling lungs. But my memory is good. I remember all the tall tales and most of the facts. Memory and stories are powerful tools of rebellion. I have long been a rebellious man, and now I am quickly being disarmed. In my most lucid hours, I type a few pages, while on spottier memory days, I dictate to my new, young, and healthy wife, baby doll, and she embellishes. I work from Kerwood Hospital, a black-owned, black-operated, and black-staffed institution, where I have been sequestered for going on 3 months as life, stealthily some days, boldly other days, evacuates the premises of my once agile dancer's body. I continually thank my friend, Dr. Guy Otha Salisbury, who founded Kerwood in 1943 in a stately Motor City mansion at 301 East Kirby, not far from where I would later found the Ziggy Johnson School of the Theater in a modest concrete box. Comforting me, extending my last trip around the sun, always near are the brown and tender, well-trained hands, fluttering or poking of nurses and doctors, able and ready to battle death. My life began in a Southside Chicago shotgun apartment owned by an Ofe. Now, it's pleasant to anticipate dying in a mansion owned by a black man and being in the care of doctors trained at Meharry and Howard. Not every memory is pleasant. Like the plans that John Woolley and I had to buy the Rum Boogie and make it a club of the highest caliber. This last effort, to return to my school triumphantly restored to health, fizzled. But before I fizzled, I burned bright. For the past 20 years, I have worn three hats, each of them dapper, and all in Detroit. Writer, emcee, and dean. Hat one. Following in the wake of the great sepian entertainment columnists in our papers, Sylvester Russell, Dave Payton, and the inimitable Salem Tutt Whitney, I write a weekly entertainment and gossip column for Detroit's colored paper, the Michigan Chronicle. I was in the inaugural issue of Duke Magazine, the black, better than Esquire, men's publication. If you count the variations of my Detroit columns published in the Chicago Defender and the Pittsburgh Courier, I have published over 1,000 articles, and still counting. Now, I am posting from this hospital room. If Jesus loves me, and if Ethel Waters prays hard, my last column will be published after I die, but before I am buried. Hat 2. I emcee at the swankiest club in town. For a long time it was The Flame, but now I'm presenting Barry Gordy's top talent in the Driftwood Lounge, the almost private club hidden inside the very public 20 grand. You may say, hold up. You can't be a patient in Kerwood and the master of ceremonies at the Driftwood Lounge. I say, I pick the acts, I write the intros, I scold whoever is too drunk to go on stage or too drunk to get off, even if Baby Doll must drag the miscreant to my sick bed for the scolding. I, following in the footsteps of Eddie Pleak, am the emcee. Hat 3. I preside as the unofficial dean of the Ziggy Johnson School of the Theater, where I teach the breadwinner's children. That word explains Detroit to me. Breadwinner. The partying factory people were those whom I first noticed when I arrived in the late 30s. Large numbers of black men who earned a good, steady wage doing a skilled job, then returned to the homes they owned, ready to refuel and to dress to the nines, to head out to hear fabulous music and drink good liquor. I was the breadwinner's emcee of choice and producer of choice, and proud to be so. Songs, lines of dialogue, beats of choreography that Ofe and mixed audiences loudly applauded in Chicago, Los Angeles, or New York clubs were often met with silence in Detroit show bars. For 20 years, I created my best work planned to a sepian Detroit audience of breadwinners and their entourages. It wasn't just black factory folk in the audience, but on most nights, in most places, most people in the audience were there because of the factory folk. Black doctors, lawyers, ministers, businessmen, gamblers, dry cleaners, hairdressers, barbers, restaurateurs, teachers, policemen, firemen, bus drivers, gas station attendants, car salesmen, newspaper columnists, grocery store owners, funeral parlor directors. We all lived off the wages of factory folk. Back in the day, because of the breadwinners, Detroit could support all black hospitals and all black private schools, and even exclusive all-black beach resorts. The factory folk, the breadwinners, drove the black city. Black Detroit knew this. We gave the factory folk who worked in the automobile plants their proper respect. We loved those men who did that shift work that meant 8 out of 10 black families in Detroit owned the home they lived in and could afford to go out to a club to hear live music any night they chose. Our breadwinners built this city. We remember when River Rouge ran 24/7. Three shifts a day at the plants meant the show bars had two shows on Sunday and late shows every night, sometimes at 2 a.m. for those who got off the late shift. That was the opportunity that created Caramel Camelot. All black Detroit audiences were fire. They brought a rare light and a heat that rated black achievement and performance by a black yardstick. It was nothing unusual for a breadwinner or a breadwinner's wife to go to 52 shows a year. It was unusual, but not rare, to go to even 150 shows a year. Some breadwinners went to over 250 shows in a given year. The breadwinners heard so much excellent music that they became experts. And the more expert they became, the more everybody wanted to play Detroit. It was a self-perpetuating cauldron of sepia excellence. I stirred that pot. I wanted to do something for the breadwinner's children because the breadwinners had done so much for Detroit, and there's nothing a breadwinner loves more than a breadwinner's baby. I taught the breadwinner's babies, and I did not just teach them to be dancers. Week after week, hiding behind practicing new steps and learning sophisticated choreography, I shared stories that put a limelight on the Black Bottom Saints, people who had suffered so much and so differently, but who had each found a way or made a way to experience radical joy. In my classes, I dropped bits and pieces about the saints' lives like breadcrumbs that marked a path out of the automobile plant for the breadwinner's children. I did this to celebrate and honor what the breadwinners did outside the factory, make worthy and beautiful babies, and be worthy and beautiful their own sometimes damned selves. And once a year, always on Father's Day, my school of the theater presents the extravagant recital that Black Detroit calls Youth Colossal at the legendary Latin Quarter Lounge. On that day, there are no white faces in the Latin Quarter, none. There are just our children on the stage, and everybody in the audience looking at our boys and our girls has the same thoughts. He is the second coming of Christ. She is the next Virgin Mary. And Lord, don't all the bronze apostles look good? Youth, the seven most radical words in the Bible, and a little child shall lead them. From the day it opened in 1952, the Ziggy Johnson School of the Theater was a citizenship school. I did not run a dancing school. We were rehearsing for the theater of life. I have seen Butter Beans and the little genius Sammy Davis Jr. perform. I well know we don't need a school to learn to dance. From jump, it was my ambition to educate boys and educate girls to be dangerous citizens. By the time we were open for a few years, I was focusing on the girls. In Detroit, the boys and men were doing okay, or at least so I thought. The girls had it harder. I've known too many young, brilliant, precise women with heads for numbers who never considered attending medical school, never gave two shakes for Meharry or Howard. And I've known women who could argue the paint off a wall and didn't dream of law. I've seen girls who got raped, blamed themselves, not the man, then got talked into thinking sex was evil and they were dirty. And I have also seen women driving Cadillac cars, wearing furs, who have never voted. That's what I set out to change at the Ziggy Johnson School of the Theater. Autonomy, ambition, renewal, pride, and creativity are the five basic positions we teach. That is why the big performers, the Supremes, the Mills Brothers, the Temptations, Gladys Knight, and the marvelous Marvin Gaye loved to step to the stage and play my kid show where they remembered and played for the little boy or little girl they once were, who, if they wanted to sing just for home folk, had no place to perform, except in a church or a juke joint. All my girls will say, I was raised by a village of saints. They will say, Ziggy filled our heads, his citizen girls, with the lives of his saints, who whispered encouragement and clapped us forward as we spotted to hard-won happy. They will say, God doesn't make saints, people do. When they ask for something and it is given. One will say, kidnapping, rape, and a Judas kiss were eclipsed by step together, step together, step together, step. Another will say, it's not just us Black folk who need Ziggy's book, it's everybody. The girls will say things I don't say. Now, in my last days, I am wearing a fourth hat, Saints Day book author. I wrote a Saints Day book. I don't know anybody else alive, Black or white, who's done that. Saints Day books usually list feasts and dates, along with a little biography of the saint being honored. Detroit likes to do things a little different than they've been done before. My Saints Day book includes biographies, plus cocktails in celebration of the saints, and provides recipes and instructions on how to make them. Regular Saints Day books don't do a thing about helping you make a feast. They just tell you on what day to do it. I'm not telling you exactly on what day to have your cocktail, but I am instructing you exactly how to make it thanks to one of my favorite saints, Thomas Bullock. The best cocktail man I ever knew was Bullock. In Detroit, people spend a whole lot of time in bars drinking cocktails. Every bar I ever walked into was improved by my knowing that every bar in America owes something to one brilliant sepian, Thomas Bullock, the greatest bartender of all, and the first black man ever to publish a cocktail recipe book. All black folk, hell, all folk, can be a particular kind of proud when they walk into a bar if they think about Bullock and all he knew about altering perception to improve reality. Sometimes we start celebrating ourselves by celebrating the ones who brought us over. My Saints Day book gives you precise ways to do just that. I am not sorry to be dying. I was born with the gift of premonition.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.